ring of a bell comes to you on a cold wind. The ring comes again and again, until soon the air is full with the sound of a thousand, thousand bells ringing all at once. You are alone. And then, you are not. An indistinct figure stands before you, flickering between forms like a fire-cast shadow. A fixed, taunting grin. Bottomless black eyes. A yawning chasm in the earth. The aspects of Bareth, the Usher, and the Pallid Knight shift in and out of focus. And at their back, four indistinct shades hover. You feel an eternity stretch out behind each of them, reaching back to places so distant and yet so near you cannot comprehend their size. The shifting image of Bareth settles on the aspect of the Pallid Knight.
Watcher.
Her voice is the discordant clangor of gongs struck out of time.
I tasked you to discover Aethys's intentions. Tell me what you have learned.
The Pallid Knight knits her brows.
He does not seek to return to the beyond? Intriguing.
Her sickly pale skin pulls tight across the bones of her face, as if the shell of this aspect does not quite fit the impossible creature it contains. The figure nearest Bareth dissolves and reforms in the image of a thin-lipped ancient crone whose face has felt the melting kiss of fire. The goddess Wodica strides forward.
Does Aethys frighten you, Bareth? He should. Magron subdued Aethys' influence once before, and yet he returned.
From out of Wodica's shadow shuffles a hunched, bald man you recognize as the god Scan. His skin is mapped with swollen lash scars, and breath whistles through the ragged hole in his face where his nose once was. He does not speak, but stares up at Wodica with naked loathing plain on his ruined face. Wodica steeples her long, knob-jointed fingers.
We must annihilate Aethys now before he makes a rash decision we cannot easily annul.
She casts a sly look at the Pallid Knight from the corners of her eyes.
A moon would do the job nicely.
Wodica stares at you down her long nose.
I would destroy it all in the blink of your wide eye if I believed it would benefit me. Empires can be rebuilt. Souls can be reforged. Do not forget.
The figure beside the aspect of Bareth flows forward in a swirling cloud of ash. The ash falls to the tiles and reveals a molten-skinned woman leaning on a monstrous, wicked-edged broadsword. Mogren's glowing lips curl in disdain.
We must find a solution to the problem of Aethys that is neither do nothing nor destroy the world. I acted in haste during the Saints' War. You will not goad me into doing the same now. To move against him while his plans are unknown would be the height of foolishness. We must find wisdom in precaution.
Mogren looks at you as one might a wayward gob of spit on one's shoe.
It is no business of yours what the gods decide.
Another of the silent figures steps forward, and the warm, golden light of a summer's afternoon spills across your face.
Let's all take a deep, calming breath. Perhaps cooler heads will prevail.
Behind Helia's words, you hear the soft coo of doves.
Aethys has been separated from us for too long. Isn't it possible he intends only to gather enough souls to reclaim his realm in the beyond? He should be welcomed.
You look up then into avian eyes. Through them, you see clouds of starlings converge and divide. Helia puts a feathered hand to her chest.
He wouldn't. Betrayal is not in his nature.
Scan shuffles forward.
Yes, yes. We should welcome Aethys's return to the fold. His gratitude we can leverage to cajole him into divulging his plot. Then, when he believes himself to be in our good graces, we do as Wedica suggests, and crush him into the earth.
Scan pauses, inspecting you.
Ah, and here is the Watcher who killed Lord Harren, the man who tormented his dear niece, Alys. Curious.
Scan licks the ragged edge of his lipless mouth and grins, then turns to Helia.
I did not expect such a deliciously ruthless idea from you, Helia. I am impressed.
Helia's feathered crest stands on end.
You wretched little creature.
Your point is well made, little Watcher. If self-evident, Aethys has not been known to possess a vindictive nature. Indeed, he has occasionally been magnanimous to a fault. However, if we push him to the brink of reason, there is no telling what he may do. He is, as ever, unpredictable.
Something akin to fondness creeps into her voice. The pallid knight gestures for silence.
Aethys cannot be killed, but he may be subdued. Yet to do so will take immense power and time. Both stand in his favor.
Maugryn grits her black glass teeth.
That is why we must ascertain his plans before he has the chance to put them into motion.
She begins to pace. Her steps leave little trails of fire in her wake. Maugryn stops and balls her hands into flaming fists.
Even if we manage to destroy his current form, there is the possibility he could return if he has not already absorbed all of his children.
The pallid knight casts a cold, cutting glare in Maugryn's direction.
Maugryn speaks too freely. That knowledge is beyond your ken, Watcher.
Wotica waves the gods to silence.
Aethys gathers strength. His strength is a threat to us.
Her voice takes on a sharp, almost panicked edge.
There is no sensible answer to the question of a resurgent Aethys other than decisive, final action.
Your opinion is unasked for and unnecessary, but noted nonetheless.
Though her tone is impassive, the banked fury in her eyes says well enough what she thinks of your interruptions.
We will act when it is appropriate to do so, and not before.
The pallid knight steps away from the half-circle of assembled gods. She pulls herself up to a great height. The words she speaks next come not from her mouth, but from all around you.
Follow him, Watcher.
The black of the pallid knight's irises expand until her eyes are as dark and cold as the void between stars. She bends down and brings her ghostly face level with your own.
Your debt to me remains unpaid.
She stares at you, unblinking. Like a needle drawn to a magnet, you are pulled toward her one compulsory step at a time. You blink open your eyes and find yourself on the floor of your ship's cabin, alone.
Give me a real challenge. I got this.
you're far from home, farmer. How did you make it all this way in your little boat?
Why do we gotta be farmers just because we're from Deerwood?
Are you a farmer?
Yeah, but you can't just assume. We got rabble-rousers, too.
I'm the harbor master, Kaoha. I must ask your reason for docking in Nekataka. Yeah, you do need to see someone, truly. I think it's the animancers in the spire you're looking for. To help with your head.
Show them what you are.
I've heard enough. There's no room for you in Nekataka Harbor. Get back on your ship and head back to open sea.
I will help you.
What's the matter with you? What are you doing? If you're trying to scare us with some cipher mischief, save the purple flames for the tribes of the Outer Islands.
Now.
What? What is this?
Run for it!
You got style, Cap. Worm-riddled, ship-sinking, flat-fucking, freaky style.
Thank you.
Hey there. Be right there.
I? Oh? What?
Now Port Marge is behind us. I thought this would be a relief.
Must think I work for free. Be with you in just a... almost had it. Damn your eyes. Hazard of the work, really. Came in on the sloop? I can hammer your ship together if you're apt to pay me for it. Aye. Captain Radora hasn't paid me for her commissioned firepower. While I'm up to my nose in debt, the Wild Mare gobbles up her coin. And now, pirates are holding my feet to the fire over some sham of a deal. If I don't get Radora's payment, I might as well start carving my swallow net. One where I mend Principe ships and no others.
And here I'd have thought a shipwright would be eager for an exclusive contract. In particular, one with clients disposed towards getting their ships shot to shit and shot again.
Folk like that come by coin easy, only to lose it all again. I'm not sinking my business on the say-so of a pack of puffed-up bilge rats. Bastards are driving away business until I give in. You'd do that? A fair price goes without saying, Cully. It all comes down to blasted pans and pyres in the end, doesn't it? Well, come take a look.
Welcome! Venturing out past the city. You'll want supplies. Crab traps or the like for a larger game, I warrant. Of course. Take your time.
Care for a fish or two, stranger? You'll find no fresher. Have a look.
It is not as easy as it seems to turn a profit.
Need a fresh jacket or pants? Something more delicate? If you have a frame, I can fit cloth to it without fuss. Take your time. I'll give you space to browse.
Thank you.
Thank you again for maintaining my story in front of Vanessa and the others. I didn't enjoy deceiving them, but it seemed simpler than the alternative. I hoped you'd understand. Believe me, I take no pleasure in duplicity. After we parted, I set out to destroy the Leaden Key. It's controlled us for too long. I wanted to free Kith from it. So for 5 years, I've been tracking down Leaden Key circles, searching for the places where they operate in secret, trying to undo them. The task has been more difficult than I anticipated. I don't think I fully understood the weight of the decisions I would have to make, or the burden of living with them. It was much easier when I only had to follow someone else's lead. My father's, Theos's, yours. After we defeated Theos, I thought the hard part of undoing his work would be tracking down the Leaden Key's members and operations. Perhaps this would be easier with an example. I went to a village in Old Valia, a run-down backwater of a place. Centuries ago, the Leaden Key had intervened to end some heretical cult. The details were lost, but what had endured was a practice of ritual bloodletting. A gruesome, pointless tradition.
You got an eye for charming little towns, I'll say that much.
At every full moon, the villagers would feed the soil with their blood. No one, young or old, sick or hale, was exempt. The village priest administered the practice. Grim old fellow. Reminded me of Theos. He was a tyrant. I was certain that if the villagers were free of his influence, they'd be free from the bloodletting too. So I arranged for him to have an accident. The old man died. And the villagers were terrified. They were convinced his death was an ill omen. They blamed it, and every other mishap that befell them, on their lack of faith. So they began bloodletting every week, turning on their neighbors for giving too little. Instead of a handful dying each year, a few perished every week. I had to do something, didn't I? I keep wondering what I might have done differently, or how I could have known better. I suppose so. Thank you. It's a relief to share this burden. You've given me a lot to think about. Ah, that. I'm looking for an old Leaden Key sect. I've found several references, but I want to be sure. Please, let me go over my notes again. Then I promise I'll tell you everything.